Well, as you look right there at that Louisville Cardinal and his breath being very visible in the air, Memphis, Tennessee, at the Liberty Bowl tonight, as we had mentioned early on in our cut into Sports Center, the weather conditions not so good. Let's go down to the field and check in with Adrian Karstad. Adrian?
Ron, you're right. Expect the weather to play a part in the outcome of this game. We're currently under a winter storm advisory in Tennessee, if you can believe that. And what that means is that the mist is falling right now is going to turn into freezing rain. Now, the field is somewhat slick. A lot of rain earlier today, but the field was not covered with tarp. But it's the temperature, guys. It's really going to cause problems for quarterback Jeff Brown. Because of the broken finger, the colder it gets, the more pain he has, the harder it's going to be to grip the ball. And, Coach, he told me something else. Even though they were dunking his footballs in these buckets of ice water yesterday at practice, even if he was totally healthy, he does not like to handle a wet ball because his hands aren't very big.
Well, Adrian, if I'm Howard Snellenberger and they're expecting freezing rain here, I'm going to come out and fire the football. Go to the shotgun offense, Ron, and pump the football up here early. Try to get some points quick.
There you see the numbers on Coach Howard Snellenberger, 47-51-2. And something that not a lot of people in the stands understand tonight, he is playing hurt. 102 fever just before this ball game, we just learned. Look at his losses this year. Number 3, number 6, and number 7. All of those games were on the road. The teams that defeated Louisville this year, 32-1. Very impressive. So as you see, the Cardinals actually could easily have a better record had they played an easier schedule. And George Perlis across the way, 11 years at Michigan State. You see his numbers. Take a look at the teams they lost to. Also, they played a very tough schedule. Number 4, number 9, 11, 13, and 21. A total of 45 victories. So, Mike, actually two teams that come in here that you look at their records, actually they are better football teams and maybe what they look like on paper.
And another chance to prove their season, Ron, here in this bowl game.
Akers will kick it off as you look at Scott Green, number 47. And to the near side, Derek Mason. Akers will kick it off. This is a natural turf field here in Memphis. It is very green, as you can tell from our cameras high on top of the stadium, but it has been painted. Rain last night and also throughout the day, and thank goodness now the rain has stopped. It is a mist that is coming down, and we will see if the conditions worsen as the evening goes on. Akers with a hand above his head. Our referee tonight for the Southeastern Conference is Jimmy Harper. Akers moves forward, and the 35th Liberty Bowl game is underway. This will come to Mason at the 5. To the 20, and out to the 21-yard line. So let's check the starting lineups for Michigan State tonight. Jim Miller, his head coach, says he thinks he'll play on Sunday. He thinks he has the complete package. The man they want to get the ball to, Mill Coleman. He's a junior out of Farmington Hills. Very good high school quarterback, but he is the blister speed guy. Big plan, 5 pounds. And up front of the offensive line, Shane Hanna. Second team, all Big Ten. He is the best of the offensive linemen for the Spartans. Craig Thomas lines up as the lone setback in the backfield for Michigan State, and they go run. Comes to the right side, breaks off one tackle, breaks off another, and he's going to have a gain of 9. Watson on the stop, and here are the starters for the Louisville Cardinals. Joe Johnson out of St. Louis, the best of that down 4. Very active linebackers. You remember Tom Cavallo, the last time that we saw this football team from Louisville, he had 14 tackles against Texas A&M. He's a good one. And in the secondary, Anthony Bridges. In fact, a lot of the pro scouts think that this young man is going to be awfully good when they get him in the pros. He starts at left corner. Possibly with an audible, this time with two backs as Abrams comes in at the fullback spot. On the draw, Thomas, left side, and he will be close to the first down at the 31-yard line as Terry Quinn comes up to make hit.
It's obvious that the plan for George Perlis offensively with this big offensive line is to come out and run the football tackle to tackle and try to wear out this defense a little bit because they have a big size advantage.
Dwayne Goldburn checks into the lineup. Look at the difference, Mike, and what you're talking about.
6'5", 305 as compared to 6'3", 246. And they've got two defensive ends for Louisville, 245 and 250, that they think they've got a great size advantage on and want to take advantage of it.
First and 10, you see the linebackers coming on the blitz. Backside pressure, and he throws it complete. That's Coleman, and he will take it across midfield and down to the 49-yard line. That's Bridges holding on for dear life, but it's a gain of 19.
Milt Coleman, the wide receiver that Jim Miller likes to go to. curl route, slides to the outside, makes the catch against Anthony Bridges, an outstanding corner for Louisville.
Scott Green will come into the lineup at fullback. He's a sophomore out of Canandaigua, New York, number 47. And Goldburn is a teammates call him Goldie, number 27, the sophomore out of Detroit, who's had an outstanding year, comes into the game at tailback. He'll get the handoff. You see the guard pulling. Boy, he gets tagged at the line of scrimmage. And it is Kendall Brown. Kendall Brown, who comes up to make the initial hit and rock his head back. Jim Miller, extremely impressive.
He's an impressive run in the passing game that Morris Watts, the offensive coordinator, uses for Michigan State, is an underneath passing game. That's why you see the 64.9 completion percentage. Most of the throws are in the 15-yard range.
Jim, good size for a quarterback at 6'4", 208. Sets nicely in the pocket, wide open in the flat as his fullback, and Abrams has it inside the 35, and he's down to the 33. Watson has to come over and put the stopper on him.
One of the concerns you always have as a coach when you go to a bowl game is the long layoff. And Michigan State has come out really firing the football, running the football well. You see the Jim Miller, the quarterback, just hitting Bryce Abrams, the fullback, on a little option route where Bryce Abrams just 6-yard route, sits down, is able to pick up yardage after the catch.
Mike, that's a gain of 15. They had a gain of 19 a moment ago as Denton checks into the lineup, and again, two tight ends for Michigan State. Straight ahead with the running play. Dodges one, dodges his second. Thomas on his way. Close to the first down at the 23. Terry Quinn again from the secondary. And I have a feeling that Howard Schnellenberger's observation right now is, guys, too many folks, deep backs, are having to come up and make tackles.
Well, you look at Brian DeMarco there. He's 6'7", 316. And you look at the two tight ends. Now they're moving two tight ends into the ballgame. Number 99 is Bob Denton. He's an offensive guard. He's 6'5", 320 pounds. You see him blocking there. So what they've done is they've had a guard tackle Bob Denton move into the tight end spot to try to spread out Louisville, just pound the football at him. Now there goes Big Bob out. He's only, he needs a rest every now and then, one play and out.
Well, you know, Abrams is such a good blocker, and he's like a guard in the backfield, Mike. He's 6'1", 254 pounds.
Doesn't carry the ball much, mostly
nope.
A pass receiver.
But you can see he caught the ball very well a moment ago as they roll the pocket to the near side, and they throw it complete again. It's Bill Coleman, and he is roughed down around the 11-yard line, but that is good for a Spartan first down, and this opening offensive series has really turned some heads.
Well, good mix. Here's Jim Miller with a good play-action fake because they're running the ball successful. You have to be able to defend the run. Now you get your receivers one-on-one with Anthony Bridges, the corner. Good mix in this drive by Louisville, by Michigan State.
It is first and 10 for the Spartans. The ball just outside the 10-yard line. Goldburn in a tailback. Picks it off left guard. He's going to have close to 5 yards at around the 6. Fanning down at the bottom of the stack. Also Dewsbury, number 53, the senior out of Union City, California.
I said earlier about a bowl game, the big layoff you have from your last game of the year. Of course, Michigan State's coming from that game in Japan where they played against Wisconsin. Louisville's had a layoff since the Tulsa game. And always the question is, which team's going to show up to play in a bowl game?
Second down for Michigan State. It's Miller, who has been outstanding in this opening drive, again with one setback. And you see the two tight ends. They go with the running play, and this time nothing doing. At the line of scrimmage, Cavallo is the first man there. And we said he likes to make something happen. Also, Jay Fanning, number 45, he's a freshman. And he's the one that comes off the stack screaming to his teammates, hey, we can't give up an easy six right here.
Ron, Bob Denton's back in the game as a tight end. Now, one play, and now he's off. But he also tonight will wear number 60 because they need him as a guard sometimes. So he'll play with two jerseys tonight. The reason he has 99 is when he's at a tight end, to be eligible to catch a pass, he has to have that number. Can't wear 60.
Excuse me, Michael. It is third down, and they need about 5.5 yards to pick up this first down. Miller blocks the time, drops it, has it complete at the 3, at the 2, Scott Green, and he is very close to the Michigan State first down.
In this formation, Michigan State, here's number 47, Scott Green. They're going to come inside and pick for him and release him right to the flat. Jim Miller with the snap, three-step drop. Scott Green in the flat, open against the linebacker, number 41, Tom Cavallo. Good completion.
Bridges on the stop. It is a first and goal for Michigan State. The ball just 1 yard away. Goldie takes it over the left side, and Goldberg scores. 6-0, the Spartans of Michigan State.
What an impressive drive. I mean, you have to look at this drive by Michigan State. Morris Watts, the offensive coordinator for George Perlis. Good mix. You see Morris there on the sideline. Good mix with the run. Impressive first drive by the Spartans.
Bill Stojanovic, his brother kicked in this game, and of course the name is familiar because his older brother kicks for the Miami Dolphins. He will attempt the extra point and try to put the team to the Big Ten up by 7, and they have it. So as we go to break, let's take one more look and watch impressive blocks by this man, 63, Shane Hannon, and also Colin Cronin. 7-0 Spartans. Is the man back deep to accept this kickoff from Bill Stojanovic. Good driving kick. He'll take it at the 7.
20, 25 and out to the 30-yard line. Let's meet the starters on offense for the Cardinals tonight. Jeff Brohm, and also, you see, we mentioned Marty Lowe. He is the backup. He's got to be prepared to play.
Brohm threw well in the warm-ups tonight. Mike went down on the field and took a closer look at him. The wide receiver, Bailey, is the man. They just got the kickoff return from. He's the guy they want the ball in his hands. He is the breaker. And up front, a consistent and good offensive line. Dave DeBole, the senior at right guard, is the leader up front, the most consistent of those offensive linemen for the Cardinals. Jeff Brohm and Mike, let's just take a look, and they will start off in the shotgun formation, just what you talked about. Easier on his aim. From the pressure, he's going to have to play. He's going to get a chance to hit some local folks tonight. He is from Louisville, has 7 sacks. That leads the team. The linebackers, they're very, very active, but they're led by 83, Rob Fredrickson. He's a senior. They get his senior leadership. Myron Bell in the secondary normally starts at corner. They've had to move him over to free safety because of the Steve Waslick. Second down and 9 as the Spartans try to show blitz. They stay at home. And again, Louisville from the shotgun formation. Brohm deep over the middle. Got it complete. Ferguson inside the 40, and he's down to the 37-yard line. Stopped by Demetrius Martin.
Ron, I think that pass is the most important pass that Louisville's Jeff Brohm has thrown. Brohm has thrown his entire career because there was a question with his finger. Tape job. This is the first been able to throw in a game-type situation since he hurt his finger. Seemed pushing a little bit, but it's right on the money to Reggie Ferguson for a big gain.
Ferguson, a senior out of Jacksonville, 5'9", 182, grabs the reception. The I formation, it's Dawkins, little counterplay. Trying to get him outside of the left. He is stuck hard at the line of scrimmage. Let's go down and check in with Adrian Karsten. Adrian, what do you have for us?
Ron, we have described the injury to quarterback Jeff Brohm. Now let's take a look at it. This is Thanksgiving Day, November 25th, against Tulsa. You see the push out of bounds, and the play had actually been blown dead at this point. Look at him go over the bench. Now watch as he makes contact with the wall. Bang. His right hand between the wall and his helmet. He came off complaining to the orthopedic surgeons about back and neck problems, obviously, but it was the middle phalanx bone of his index finger that he broke after this play. Got some words on his rehab for you, Ron.
Okay. Adrian, again, he'll go with the shotgun formation on a second down and long. Pressure from his right. Delivers it and has it complete over the middle to Dawkins. Breaks the tackle. He'll go down to the 20-yard line, and it will be first down for the Louisville Cardinal, and Brohm is being helped up. It's good for 16 yards, but he got tagged by Juan Hammonds.
Good little short pass to Ralph Dawkins, but you're going to see Jeff Brohm's going to take some hits tonight from Michigan State. Ball thrown, gets hit right after the play by Juan Hammonds. Good completion. You see the hit he takes. They'll just keep trying to pound him all night.
Well, the numbers on Jeff Brohm for the season, 60, almost 61%, and 2,600 yards.
Tight end, he likes the tight end, Jamie Asher.
gets it out in the flat, tipped in, almost intercepted. Aldi Henry, the freshman out of Montreal, Quebec, cut in front, and wow, there was a lot of running room if he holds on.
Tried to go to Jamie Asher, the tight end. Aldi Henry, who is out of Montreal, Canada, went to the summer camp at Michigan State, and that's how they knew about him ability-wise, and he's a true freshman starting at the strong safety position. There's Aldi.
Good play right there to knock it down, but as we said, he was within another step of real glory. Second down and 10. Fakes to Dawkins, rolls that pocket, lobs it out, and complete at the 12 to Fitzpatrick. He juggled it for a moment, then held on, and with the spot right here, Mike, he's not going to have the first down.
Good catch, Ron, by Chris Fitzpatrick. His brother, Tony's a coach at the University of Houston, played for Howard at Miami, Florida. What a catch by Chris Fitzpatrick. This is a fake again, a good fake by Jeff Brahms, able to get his shoulder square to the line of scrimmage against Rob Fredrickson, number 83 in coverage. Third and short.
Now, if we had any question marks about this young man, here are his early returns, 3 of 4, 57 yards. This time he will take the snap from under center. As Mike said, here he's had to reverse the snap. Pitches to Dawkins, tries to turn the corner. And that is a great job of containment. Again, it's Henry, as Michigan State simply would not let him turn the corner. Juan Hammond's another one with a good lateral pursuit.
They were able to string the play out and force it to the sideline, which is not what you want, not what Howard Snellenberger wants in a toss sweep. You want that play to cut up as quickly as possible.
David Akers will come on to attempt the field goal, and they're going to place it down at the 21. The wind right now is not a factor in the game. Maybe just a slight breeze coming at him, but it's going to be an attempt up 31. Good pass and a good kick. So let's take a break. 7:07 left in this opening quarter. Both teams on the board. Spartans up by 4. Picking it up right here tonight in this 35th Liberty Bowl game.
Most interesting thing in the drive, the first drive, was Michigan State's ability to pound the ball at Louisville. I look for Louisville to try to get into some 8-man fronts here in this series to try to slow down the running game.
Akers with the kick. This is very short. It's going to be taken at the 19-yard line. To the 25 and now to the 30. Good running by Marvin Wright, backup quarterback and also defensive back, and he'll take it to the 33-yard line. So 14 on the return as the kick comes down at the 19.
Louisville cannot let Michigan State's offensive line dominate them like they did in that first drive. They have to have the ability to stop the running game, at least slow it down, because when you run the ball like Michigan State did in that first drive, Jim Miller is going to have a field day throwing a play-action pass.
Mike, what's going to be the key then? The minute that you see the two big tight ends up there, particularly Denton, that you come up in an 8-man?
Move one of the safeties, either strong safety or free safety, up to give you the extra man.
Miller, pressure up the middle, looking to throw the screen. There's a flag. It's going to be offensive holding. And in fact, it was very obvious right up the middle.
And where he has the flag, this is really going to set him back if it is holding.
Because it comes from the point of the infraction. You can see Jimmy Harper is the man who is the referee tonight, who threw the flag.
I think they were holding Jay Fanning, number 45. That may be the call.
During the play, holding offensive line 10 yards from the spot of foul.
Ron, the reason they were holding Jay Fanning is because Jay Fanning read the screen. Now, here he is. He's pressuring and being held by number 79, Brian DeMarco. Jim Miller could not get rid of the football because the screen back was not set.
Okay, Mike, so now let's look and go back to the point that you made. Because if from the point of the infraction, the line of scrimmage is now the 14-yard line, and they need to take it all the way to the 42-and-a-half to pick up the first down.
Big penalty. Here's the 8-man front, too. We talked about Louisville's in an 8-man front defense.
They go to the running play, and Thomas nothing doing at the line of scrimmage. Joe Johnson, also Dewsbury, coming up together to make the hit along with Ben Sumter, number 36.
Ron, the ability to stop the run, sometimes you have to go to 8-man fronts. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now that makes it a little bit easier to try to control the run. Now what Michigan State will do, they'll, when they catch him in the 8-man front, they'll try to get the ball to Mill Coleman.
Good look right there at number 45, Jay Fanning. They want to throw on second down and long. Miller steps up, has it complete, and just the man that Mike was talking about as the ball was turned over, or was it? Coleman, now they're going to say an incomplete pass. That's a consensus, as three different officials came in and said, nope, didn't hold on to the football at the 25. Bridges is the man who stuck him.
Big hit by Bridges. Ty Smith, the defensive coordinator, was talking about Anthony Bridges. He said he knows once the game starts and after watching films what receivers will do. He reads routes very well. He's a coach on the field. And you see the break he makes after Milt Coleman.
That's a good call. It went right through the breadbasket.
Terry Quinn hit him. Terry Quinn was the first man there. Milt Coleman, the receiver.
Third down and 30. Goldberg gets the ball on the draw. Gets by one tackler, then will be tripped up at the 18-yard line. Kevin Gaines is the man who took his feet out from under him. And Mike, on that exchange and that huge penalty, Louisville stands to get excellent field position.
Ron, you're right. The penalty was a big play. Then Louisville now is in a guessing game with Michigan State. Because of the big offensive line, they have to pick their spots to go to the eight-man front.
Chris Solani to punt it. You see his average on the season. And Aaron Bailey, who averages 13 yards of return, is back deep. Not a long kick. Bailey with a fair catch and makes it at his own 49-yard line. So let's take a break. 7-3 Spartans. We'll be right back. Come away with a touchdown. He had a field goal, but right now they take it over 51 yards away.
Now it looks like Dawkins is lined up at fullback. If that's the case, he's a pass receiver out of that position.
Play action. They're going to go up on top. Got a man open. Bailey tipped away, almost intercepted. Bailey drew double coverage as Martin and Myron Bell both came over on him.
And you could see the long ball fluttered a little bit in the air, where I think Jeff Brom, had he been healthy, would have been able to get a little bit more on that football. Just was in the air too long. Talking about sometimes Louisville will put Ralph Dawkins at fullback. He's their tailback, and bring in Anthony Shellman at tailback, the bigger tailback. When they do that, they like to throw the ball to Ralph Dawkins out of the backfield. He's at fullback again.
The difference in size, Dawkins is 5'9", 195, and Anthony Shellman is 6'3", 200. This time they roll the pocket to that open side. The pass incomplete. Wanted Asher as tight end. He just overthrew it.
Had him wide open, Ron. I mean, wide open in the middle. Just didn't throw the ball accurately.
Well, you can see that the strides that Louisville is taking to make sure that A, Brom doesn't get hit, and B, he doesn't take a chance of even hitting his hand on a headgear, which would send him to the sideline immediately, as they continue to roll the pocket, also using play action. But whatever they can do to free him up for one more count to get the pass away. Third down, and the line to make is the 41 of Michigan State. Brown hit from behind, and he's going to be sacked. That's Glover.
All the defensive linemen, three of the defensive linemen, Rich Glover, who just made that tackle, Aaron Jackson, and Juan Hammonds, all came to Michigan State as middle linebackers, beefed up a little bit. Now they're defensive linemen. They were middle linebackers in high school.
Brookfield to kick it away, and the man he's punting to is Mill Coleman, the speedster out of Farmington Hills. Four minutes and 40 seconds left to play in his opening quarter. 7-3 to get the pressure on. He gets away a wobbly kick and good coverage by Louisville. He will not have an opportunity to return this one. Ball is dead at the 27. Well, the Thrifty Car Rental Bowl Week continues on ESPN. Tomorrow at 8 o'clock Eastern Time, it is Wyoming taking on number 20, Kansas State. That's the Weiserlock Copper Bowl out in Tucson. Then let's move ahead. The Holiday Bowl the next day on Thursday, BYU against number 11, Ohio State. And have a look at Friday. It is a triple header. We'll go for the Independence Bowl at 12:30 Eastern Time to the Peach, then to the...
Dead ball. Before the snap, we have offside, defensive team, the first down and five.
Jim Hanna got a little too anxious, jumped across and made contact. Been a very quick first quarter here in Memphis at this 35th Liberty Bowl contest. Michigan State 7, Louisville 3 if you just joined us. handoff and tripped up the middle is Thomas, and here comes a late flag in, and that was thrown by the umpire.
Well, Jim Hanna just exploded. I know he was offside to play before, but he waited this time.
And doing call. The run, holding offensive line.
Well, Mike,
10 yards from the spot of foul.
Two penalties, offensive holding this early in the ball game, usually tells you that your offensive line is having trouble controlling the folks up front they're trying to block.
Well, they had such success in the first drive. Here's a holding call on Colin Cronin, number 66.
And the difficult situation here for Jim Miller is, again, he is playing deep in the hole. He gets another look what do we got?
First down. 15.
First
that 5-yard penalty helped him when Louisville jumped offside.
Line to make is the 36. Goldberg on the draw. Gets to the outside. Has 5, has 10. Got it off to 15, 16, and 17 as Quinn tripped him up. But he will have the run all the way out to the 42-yard line.
Picked up a good block by Milt Coleman on the outside.
Let's check in with Adrian Karsten. Adrian?
Brought an adjustment from the offensive bench of Michigan State. When Louisville Cardinals get in that 4-3 defense, the Michigan State offensive line is having trouble getting to the middle linebacker. What they're going to do now is send the tackle down on the defensive tackle and bring that guard around, what they call a horn block when I was playing ball, but difficult time getting to the middle linebacker, hoping this adjustment now going to get the job done.
It's a good blocking scheme because you bring the guard around to try to get the middle linebacker. It's tough to pick the middle linebacker up the 4-3 defense. Good adjustment by Michigan State.
Great drop this time. Swings the pass out of the flat. Goldberg gets by a tackler at the 40. Comes to the 46-yard line, and Goldberg so far has demonstrated he has a great ability to make you miss as Dewberry finally pushes him out of bounds.
Well, he's the most versatile of the tailbacks. They use three tailbacks, but he has good speed and good hands out of the backfield. You see him run the football, then he comes right back. They throw a little flare pass to him. He makes you miss, as you talked about, and he's off and running here in the first quarter.
Well, also a good look in that huddle at big number 99, Robert Denton. So that means that they got two huge tight ends in there right now, two wide receivers and one setback. Goldberg goes left side, and I believe he's going to have the Michigan State first down. Johnson is down at the bottom of the pile. Well, here are the three tailbacks that we'll see tonight. Goldberg, Thomas, and Holman. And Mike, when you look at the production there, that's awfully good. 2,000 yards plus for those three gentlemen.
Even when Michigan State had Lorenzo White, they still believe in using two, three tailbacks. And the reason is they don't want to get one tailback beat up during a ball game. And in the fourth quarter, they believe those three players, the tailback, will be fresh. Eight-man front by Louisville trying to stop the run. Could get a checkoff by Michigan State.
He's looking for Abrams, his fullback. Throws the safety bow to the other side, and Goldberg is wrapped up, and that's a nice defensive play on the near side by Sumter. Number 36, the senior out of Jacksonville.
Well, when a team jumps in the eight-man front, what do you do offensively? You see the eight men by Louisville. Jim Miller checks off and makes now and gets out of the running play and decides to throw a pass here against the eight-man front. Looks to the left first. Nothing's open. He's able to dump the ball off to his running back, Dwayne Goldberg. A checkoff against the eight-man front of the University of Louisville.
And Goldberg comes out of the lineup. Thomas comes back in. As Miller sets, going to throw medium range shot. Did he catch it in bounds? They say yes at the 35-yard line. That is right in front of the Louisville bench. And the Louisville folks don't think that Napoleon Outlaw came down with 1 foot in bounds.
Napoleon Outlaw was about 5 years old when I was coaching at the University of Cincinnati with Tony Mason back in 1975. His dad played for us at Cincinnati, was a real fine wide receiver. And this young guy used to come out all the time and catch footballs at an early age, and makes you feel old.
Mikey also did a good job. He could see on the replay a good angle. He not only got one, it looked as though he got that other foot down as well. Miller sets in the pocket. Pressure is on. Swings it out of the backfield. Craig Thomas is the man that he wanted, but the pass is overthrown and he was well covered out there in that flat.
Thought the key in this football game for Louisville would be the front four. Have to be able to control the running game, also get a pass rush. Joe Johnson, 94, Jim Hanna, number 95, Kendall Brown, 85, Leonard Ray, 97. For Howard Snellenberger to win this football game, those four have to pressure Michigan State on offense.
Well, George Perlis said yesterday, one of the things that concerned him most about this Louisville defense is the fact that if they guessed right as far as pressuring the passer, that they really could mess up a lot of things, take their rhythm away. Outlaw in motion is Miller over the middle. Nobody close on that one. And it'll stop the clock with 1:17 remaining in this opening quarter.
Ron, we talked about the eight-man front. See Morris Watts, the offensive coordinator. Now it becomes top right, number 40, Terry Quinn, will move around a little bit to try to disguise whether he's going to be in an eight-man front or stay back in the secondary. That's how they're going to try to get the extra man against the run. You try to disguise it so that Jim Miller can't get a read on you.
So, Michael, it is third down for Michigan State. They need the 25. Pressure up the middle and the pass incomplete. And, in fact, that one was wounded, it appeared, as it came close. Hannon got a hand on it. Jim Hannon, the senior out of West Palm Beach.
That was what they needed, pressure out of Joe Johnson and Jim Hanna. The pressure that they needed from the right side. Front four, the key in this ball game, 94. Joe Johnson gets there first, and Jim Hannon at a meeting at the quarterback.
So this means that Solani has to come on, and they'll have to punt the football rather than have an opportunity at a field goal attempt. Low pass, he just pooches it straight up in the air, and he's got players around it. It is down inside the 10-yard line. 29 yards on the kick. Well, College Game Day takes a look at the Orange Bowl matchup between Florida State and Nebraska, and their coaches looking for their first national championship, Mr. Bowden and Tom Osborne. Also, we'll look back at the last time Wisconsin was in the Rose Bowl, plus West Virginia, the team left out of the national championship race. We'll preview all today's bowls on College Game Day, New Year's Day, live from Miami, Florida.
I don't think they're out of the national race yet. I think they're still in it.
An undefeated team, you certainly have to say that, yes. I didn't write the copy.
No, I know that. I wasn't correcting you.
The counter goes to the right side. This is Shulman, still on his feet as he'll take it to the 15-yard line, and that's going to be a hard-nosed gain of about 8 on the play as Martin comes up to make the stop. And this is the worst start from scrimmage for Louisville in this ball game tonight.
Now, Ron, Louisville on offense, and Anthony Shulman, you see his statistics, 4.8 rushing yards. He's 6'3", 200 pounds. They need to get a running game going to take the pressure off Jeff Brown. Jeff Brown can't win this game by himself.
Well, he's going under center this time. We'll, before this evening is over, get a look at that if we can, that reversed hand taking the snap. There you see the running play. Dawkins makes a couple of folks miss, and he's going to have the first down out at the 22. Henry knocked his feet out from under him.
Here's the snap. Jeff Brom now has reversed his hands during the season. You see, he didn't take that cleanly. You know, if I was Howard Snellenberger, I'd be concerned about that during the ball game. That's why I think they'll use him a little bit more in the shotgun because, you know, for his entire career, his right hand has been on top. Now, all of a sudden, he's reversed it, taking the snap, and his right hand's on the bottom.
And you could see as a result, as that's the end of the first quarter, a little bit awkward as far as then having to turn and make the handoff. Ice. Before midnight, wind chill factor between 10 and 15 right now. So, but thank goodness no more moisture coming down than we've had. We've had excellent footing, good field conditions. Fakes it to Shulman, pass in the flat, and he's got it to Dawkins, and he takes the big hit. Well, let's talk about what Michigan State does defensively. Remember this picture right here? Former defensive coordinator for the Pittsburgh Steelers, George Perlis. Well, a guy by the name of Mean Joe Green played nose guard for him, and you remember the strange alignment that he used to give. Mike, take us from there.
Well, it's a tilt defense. 11 years ago when George Perlis was at the Pittsburgh Steelers, or 11, before that, 11 years at Michigan State, they have run the tilt defense. He had a lot of success for Chuck Noe, and we'll talk a little further after this play about the tilt defense.
Louisville with a second down. The line to make is out at the 32. They had six attempts for 10 rushing yards in that first half. Shelvin with the handoff here. He will have a couple, but that run defense, Garnett comes up to make the hit on him.
Ron, this is a traditional 4-3 defense, and when George Perlis was with the Steelers, what would happen is they had the great linebacker in Lambert, and people would get good split from the guards, and they'd block the tackles, and then they put the big center on Jack Lambert. So all of a sudden, Chuck Nolan, George Perlis came up with tilting Mean Joe Green, putting him inside there, which would draw the block of the guard and center and free up Jack Lambert to be able to run both sides. And George has had a lot of success with that defense. A little concerned about it now because he's shared so much in the last 11 years with coaches all over the country that he's afraid people may have caught up with it.
Brown delivers it over the middle. Dawkins loses the football. Handed it and dropped it. Garnett was the man who had the cover on him. And with that, the kicking unit will have to come on.
And the whole idea of the defense, as we talked about, is when you tilt a player there, the center doesn't know if he's going straight ahead. The guard doesn't know whether he's coming inside. You don't know whether there's going to be a twist from the other lineman. So you have a problem. You have to absorb two people to block him. There at the last second, he was able to come out of the tilt.
Brookfield comes on to kick it away for the Cardinals. They trail by four.
Michigan State was close on Louisville blocking the punt the last play. Howard Triplett, number 11.
Brookfield does take a little bit of extra time as Coleman picks it up in the run at the 35. And he will come out of bounds just across the 38. So let's take a timeout. 7-3 Spartans, 13-15 Crete.
Fast pain relief and no odor.
On a very cold and damp night in Memphis, Tennessee, the 35th Liberty Bowl game. Ron Franklin, along with Mike Gottfried and Adrian Karsten. 13-15 showing on the clock until halftime. And the hearty souls from Michigan said, hey, we're accustomed to this kind of weather. This is not going to bother us. And it doesn't seem to have bothered the Spartan football players so far. Thomas tries the right side, breaks off a tackle, and he's in the open. Now he's going to be caught at the 45, and here comes a late flag in. Watson had to grab on, and Mike, both tailbacks that we've seen so far from Michigan State have broken tackles and several along the way.
We have an inadvertent 5-yard face mask defensive team be added on at the end of the run, first down.
Craig Thomas now, who was the starting tailback, hurt his foot in the spring and hasn't been healthy all year. Louisville's trying to, because of the size differential, make the ball bounce outside, but the tailbacks from Michigan State are breaking a lot of tackles
really
tonight.
Yep.
And that's because of the layoff a lot of times. Fundamentally, get away from tackling. And I know it's a long season, but you got to tackle.
Goldburn comes in, replacing Thomas at tailback. He gets the handoff, and a couple of tough yards right there as Johnny Frost, number 56, will step up and make the hit on him along with Hannah.
Well, we talked to Jim Miller the other day, and quarterback from Michigan State, he said, Michigan State gave me an opportunity, and he said, I'm grateful. I've had the best 5 years of my life here at Michigan State. And when you hear a quarterback or hear a player who's played college football or college athletics, I mean, here's somebody who is really happy he was in Michigan State and played.
Interesting young man. It was fun to visit with him. Very upfront, nothing pretentious about him. You see his number, 7 of 11, as Holman now comes in at tailback, and contact made up front. Was Louisville drawn offside, or is that going to cost him? Lillard, Derek Lillard, number 83, a sophomore out of Chicago, made contact.
Dead ball, defensive, violates the neutral zone, offside, 5-yard penalty.
Well, we talked about Miller. Here's how he ranks as far as the Spartans are concerned. First in completion percentage at 62.9. In completion, second, and third in passing yardage, almost 5,000.
Ronnie had two goals when he went to Michigan State, to be the starting quarterback and take a team to the Rose Bowl. And of course, he made the starting quarterback position, but did not get his team to the Rose Bowl.
They go with a running play, and Holman is going to be tripped up at the 30. You know, yesterday he had a chance to talk with Jim Miller, and he spoke with us about his future and the possibility of playing on Sundays.
You know, I just want the opportunity to play. I don't care if I'm the first guy taken in the draft or the last guy taken. You know, I was just just as long as I get a chance, then the ball's in my court, and I'll take care of the rest. That's the way I look at it. I don't have any money now, so I'm not going to miss it. I mean, that's the way I look at it.
I don't have any money now, so I'm not going to miss it if I don't make it. That's what I mean. He's very upfront and honest.
Goulburn comes into the lineup at tailback. It is third down and short, two tight ends. And Goulburn makes somebody miss at the line of scrimmage. That was Frost, but Quinn will finish him off. And the tackle that Quinn has just made, Mike, I don't know if he got the first down or not.
I don't think he made it, Ron, but I think it's decision time for George Perlis. You got a big offensive line. Your running backs have been successful. I think you go for it here on fourth down.
Blett Laureus, senior from Akron, Ohio, 6'4", 305 pounds. Plays the right guard position, and Miller wants to talk it over with his coaching staff. So a timeout has been called. 10:35 left until
9. Backside tight end, 304 pounds.
Goulburn gets the handoff, takes it to the right side, and as you can see from that shot from our sideline camera, Johnny Frost makes the hit, but it is going to be a first down for Michigan State. Also, Joe Johnson down on the bottom of that pile, big number 94. Well, here's a look at the run and also the reaction by George Perlis on fourth down as he realizes that his team has just picked it up, and watch the head coach looking right over the shoulder of the man holding the line marker. And George likes what he saw. Goulburn, flag comes down, and it looks as though that's going to be another offensive holding against Michigan State as Sumter comes up to make the tackle. If it is, in fact, that'll be three in this first half.
During the run, holding, offensive line, 10 yards, repeat the down.
George Perlis, a very colorful coach at Michigan State, and talking to him yesterday, he said he owes everything to Ed Rutherford, who was his high school coach and 70 years old, who used to travel with the team and coached here. Duffy Doherty, the great coach of Michigan State, he said he had humor for kids, cared for kids. John McVay coached for him at Dayton. He's now at San Francisco. He said John McVay was always up, and of course Chuck Knoll. He said Chuck Knoll taught him humility. He said he was a great man to work for. He said beside his father, those four people shaped his entire attitudes in life.
Miller sets deep, throws the screen in the flat, and inside the 35 is Goulburn. That's Leonard Ray, who comes up to put the stopper on him. Very big down as far as this game has settled in offensively, as we have 9:30 left in the second quarter. And I think the Spartans probably need to come away with some points. You're thinking we're going to have a quarterback change for Louisville, aren't you?
I think without a doubt we're going to see Marty Lowe in the next series. I believe he'll come on the field, or we'll see him a series after. But not just because of Jeff Brown's injury, but you're looking at the quarterback next year, and he's been successful for him. So I think we'll see him fairly soon. I think we're going to see Milt Coleman here, a wide receiver for Michigan State.
Out in the flat, and the safe pass is dropped by Thomas. Well, Sunday, Boomer Esiason and the Jets are struggling to remain in the AFC playoff hunt. Warren Moon and the Oilers are the hottest team in the NFL and have clinched the AFC Central Division title. Now they're playing for home field advantage throughout the playoffs. That's this Sunday.
A win Sunday, tough one for Bruce Kozlik. Tough, tough season he's had. He's been very close. Just some fumbles here, jumps offside, penalties, missed field goals.
Pocket is rolled. He throws it beneath his receiver, short. Goulburn couldn't come up with that one, and it's going to be punting time again for Michigan State. So what an outstanding job for this Louisville defense to hold him.
You made a point, though, early. The fact that the two holding calls that they've had have taken them out of good field position, and they weren't able to recover. Once they got the holding penalties, plus the Louisville defense, they were not able to turn it into points.
Jelani, they've got the return, and here's a flag. Very high kick as Bailey has run away from it. Bounds at the 15-yard line, and now let's check the marker.
Has to be some kind of movement on Michigan State's punting team.
They got too many men on the field.
Wow, that's a
first.
That's
the signal with both hands over the head. Isn't that illegal
that
participation?
Is.
Participation.
Yeah.
Easy to say in regular cold, not this cold. Oh, my. Howard Schnellenberger, we mentioned, it's been a tough day now. 102 fever. He wants him to take the penalty, you can see. I'll tell you what happened to Howard this morning at 4:45.
At the end of the kick.
5:45, the fire alarm went off at his hotel. Everybody had to get out of bed and go downstairs, and there was no fire. So I have a feeling that this is a day, plus the fever for Coach Schnellenberger, that one that he'd just as soon forget parts of anyway.
I bet Howard was looking for Jeff Brom in that exchange, too. And Johnny U was going down the stairways, they said, bad knees and all.
Everybody had to evacuate, and then they got down on the streets and found out that that there was no fire. Hearing down on the sideline as we're trying to pick it up as to why the ball has been placed at the 9-yard line. We're going to take a timeout. We'll find out for you. Back with more from Memphis after this.
Out to him and said, no, I want to take it, but it was too late. Marty Lowe's in the ballgame. I think we'll see Jeff Brown back. I just think this is a move to give Marty Lowe some playing time. He's the quarterback of the future. See what he can get going here inside the 10-yard line.
Rolls the pocket. Wants to throw, and you can see the pressure, and that one is thrown incomplete. Ferguson couldn't hold on to check in with Adrian Carson.
Yeah, Coach, Ron Coach is absolutely right. This is just part of the game plan from Coach Schnellenberger. Marty Lowe is in, as I say, just part of the game plan, get him some snaps. Talk to Jeff Brown, he says as long as he keeps his hand next to that heater, he's fine. But to the receivers now, they have been told, don't compensate your routes. They've been running their routes about a yard and a half to 2 yards shorter, trying to compensate, knowing that Jeff was having a little bit of trouble releasing the ball.
Well, I think that's a great point. And the fact that, Mike, something we talked about yesterday, and then some of the receivers having the tendency to run those routes shorter to help out the quarterback. Can't do that with Lowe.
You can't do that. You can't do it with Jeff Brom either. Ron, to me, the key in this ball game for Louisville right here is number 37, Jamie Asher. He has not caught a football yet in this ball game. You see, 52 receptions, 12.7 average per catch, 3 touchdowns. For Louisville to win this football game, Jamie Asher has to get involved in this. They got to get him the football.
Well, it doesn't take long to figure out that in an 11-game season, if he's got 52, he averages at least 5 catches a game. Third down. Gets it passed away and almost intercepted right into the hands of Henry. And out he couldn't hold on to it. Probably in disbelief that that ball was thrown directly to him.
Good pressure from Juan Hammonds. Aldi Henry had the interception. He was wide open. And I believe we'll see Jeff Brown right back in here. Not because of what Marty Lowe did, but I think that's the plan. Here you see Jamie Asher, 37, the tight end. They flexed him a little bit to get him released. He's wide open down the middle. Fredrickson's close to him, but he's open. They didn't get the ball to him. Now, if I was Louisville, I'd be concerned about a blocked punt here.
Spartans with a 10-man rush at the line of scrimmage. And this time they got the return on. Fair catch called for and made by Coleman. 35 yards on the kick. And let's remind you again that tonight is the beginning of bowl week. This is what will happen tomorrow. The Weiserlack Copper Bowl. Wyoming against number 20 Kansas State. Kickoff 8 o'clock Eastern time. Then, day after that, Thursday, BYU at against Ohio State, the number 11 ranked team in the nation. The Thrifty Carbottle Holiday Bowl. Take a look at Friday. It's a triple header. We'll start off with the Independence Bowl in Shreveport at 12:30 Eastern time. Then we'll go to Atlanta and the Peach. And we'll finish off that day at the Alamo Bowl in San Antonio. Then on Saturday, Michigan against North Carolina State. That one in the Hall of Fame. 7 games in 5 days here on ESPN. Miller with the play action. Throws to a wide open Scott Green. Somebody blew a coverage badly as he'll take it inside the 20 and down to the 17.
One thing about Michigan State's fullbacks, they're not going to run the ball much. They're going to block the tailbacks, but they're both pass receivers. Bryce Ahrman, 49, and Scott Green, number 47, just brought him out of the backfield. Kendall Brown, number 85, really hit hard on the good fake by Jim Miller. Scott Green was wide open.
And you could see what happened on the sideline as Abrams came back into the lineup. Green came over and patted the hand, gave him a high five for the man that was replacing him. A congratulations from one to the other. 28 yards in that pass play. Greg Thomas.
Rodney, feed off. Michigan State feeds off the fullbacks. Rushing yardage, 7 attempts, 30 yards. Receptions, 52 for 425 yards. But the effort that Bryce Abrams and Scott Green give out of that fullback position, they're unselfish players, and the team just feeds off those fullbacks when they do something well.
Goes to Goldberg. Tries to cut it up inside, and some tough sledding around the 11 as Cavallo and Dewberry combine to make the stop for Louisville. And now it is a third down situation. Spartans lead it 7-3, and we have just over 6 minutes until halftime.
I think this is critical for Louisville to hold them out here and at least force them to the field goal, because Michigan State has dominated field position in the first half, but they only have 7 points to show for it. They can hold them here to at least the field goal, be a big win for the Louisville defense.
Draw play. Great defensive play hit in the backfield by Jim Hanna, and it will be a loss. And with that, the kicking unit with Bill Stojanovic comes trotting on.
I'm sure George Perlis on that sideline doesn't feel good about this first half. The field position they've had, Jim Hanna just beat the block. Colin Cronin, number 66, to make the tackle, and Dwayne Goldburn.
Stojanovic with an attempt of 31 yards. That's a good one. Kick is off to the right and no good.
Ron, that was big. A big defensive series for Louisville. This game could turn around on this. I mean, this was an excellent defensive series for Louisville, holding them out of there. The Ohio State football game this year, they played Ohio State tough, had them beaten as 4 field goals, and dropped the touchdown pass against the Buckeyes.
Good look at Hanna as he comes over to the sideline, the senior out of West Palm Beach. Probably doesn't get as much attention as he should. We talk about that in the Texas A&M ball game, but boy, he showed tonight.
Guess who's back?
Yep, Brougham is back at quarterback. Lobs it over the middle, complete to Dawkins. Gets a nice block and will take it close to the first down at the 30 as Martin is there defensively.
Ron, I like what Gary Nord and Howard Snellenberger did. They brought in Marty Lowe. You don't know how long Jeff Brown's going to go on this thing, and then this is the last game this year. Marty Lowe needs playing experience. Their first game next year is against Kentucky, which will be a big ball game. But Jeff Brown needed a series to watch what was going on. Now he's back in there again. Sees defense. He's protecting his hand a little bit as he falls, but he was able to sit on the sideline for a series and watch what Michigan State is doing on defense.
Shulman to the left side. He'll have the first down for Louisville. Glover is the man down at the bottom of the stack. It was Glover who put on the pressure a moment ago. And Rich, who's a senior out of Lima, Ohio, having a good defensive game in this opening half.
Ron, I'm amazed what they're doing with the snap with Jeff Brown. We said before that he's reversed his hands. His entire career, his right hand has been the top hand. Now it's the bottom hand. And watch the ball. Ball almost comes out. So far in this ball game, they've been very fortunate not to fumble a snap. And you see how he's handing the ball off.
Yeah, there's
like
no grip.
It's
exactly,
I mean,
right.
The running back has to really take the ball from Jeff Brown.
Well, there's an injured player for Louisville. Jermaine Williams, a junior out of Linwood, California. 6'4", 283 pounds, is shaken up, and they've gone out to attend to him. So Brown will take the opportunity to come to the sideline and talk it over with his coaching staff as we have 4:21 showing on the clock until the intermission. Now
Jermaine Williams played in Long Beach for George Allen. When they dropped football, Louisville went out and recruited him and brought him back to Louisville. He could play right away when a team drops football. Pass chart for Jeff Brom. And you see what they're trying to do, Ron. Just one pass past 10 to 15 yards. So most of his throws have been the throws that he can make with the bandaged hand. So I look for most of his throws to be inside the 15-yard range.
Here's another number to show you how Louisville has broken it up. Brom has been under center 10 of the 17 times. He's taken 7 of the snaps from shotgun as he will go under center again.
Still has to get Jamie Astor into this offense.
Lobs the pass, has it complete. Boy, what a hit at the 38-yard line as Asher makes his first reception.
He almost dropped this snap underneath the center. As you watch him come out of the center, Jamie Asher with the catch. Here's the snap again. And remember, he's reversed those hands. He's not used to it. Well, he's having a hard time getting the ball, getting it into his hands the way he needs to throw the football.
And you see, Mike, he has to turn the thing over to get to the laces on it. Normally, it would come right up into that right hand.
I tell you, Ron, this is a gutty performance by Jeff Brom. I'm telling you, he's in a lot of pain, and he's doing a great job of this offense.
Running play, Shellman tries to bring it to the open side of the field. And again, defensively, Michigan State with a nice job as Henry will come up and make the hit.
When you look at the Michigan State defense, I'm sure what Louisville's saying is, with the tilt defense inside, why run the ball inside? We're going to try to run it outside against George Perlis and throw the football. Now on third down, if you're Michigan State, you look for Ralph Dawkins, number 22, or Jamie Asher, number 37. Inside receivers against linebackers.
Under 3 minutes to play until halftime. Third down for Louisville. They don't want it to stop here as they need the 42-and-a-half-yard line. And the shotgun, good pressure by Michigan State. The pass thrown complete, and Dawkins lost his footing. That will be short of the first down, just across the 40.
They had Ralph Dawkins open. He just couldn't keep his feet. He would have had the first down had he been able to stand. Forced him to punt.
So Brookfield will come on to punt. And now, Mike, let's see if Michigan State, with only 2:05 left until halftime and the clock running, let's see if they do go after him.
I'm sure they'd go after Demetrius Martin, number 12, Howard Triplett, number 11. They were close on the first punt.
Good kick, his best of the night. Coleman runs away from it, and that one will take it all the way to the end zone. That is a kick of 59 yards. So let's take a break. 1:36 until halftime. Michigan State, 7-3.
Christmas without you.
Well, I'm sure we'll all be humming that for the remainder of the night.
It is first down at the 20 for Michigan State as Craig Thomas, the lone setback behind his quarterback, gets the handoff, breaks up a tackle, comes to the 27. Watson is the man who makes the stop. And in rushing for Michigan State, prior to that, 19 carries, 81 yards, and for Louisville, 10 for 16 yards.
Spend the whole first half, Louisville's inability to run the football, Jeff Brom's injury, and Michigan State not taking advantage of their field position.
Well, Louisville has just used one of their timeouts. They have two remaining. We'll hold it right here with 1:18 showing on the clock. Time of possession of the first half, we have Louisville with 11:41 and Michigan State 16:33.
To help them be the best they can be on and off the field. And that doesn't mean just playing football or doing well in school. That means taking off their hat when they come in the building. That means wearing a shirt and tie when we travel. That means doing the things and creating habits that are going to help them the rest of their life.
Ron, George Perlis is what you see is what you get. He's a fine person, an excellent coach, and I thought it was interesting the other day. He said that when he quits coaching, he wants to stay in East Lansing. He's already been promised 2 press box passes for the rest of his life for him and his wife. He wants to go to the parking lot, have a drink, and tailgate. And he wants to someday be on the Board of Trustees of Michigan State. He said, that's my school, and I care about it.
And he's very adamant about that, about becoming a part of that Board of Trustees at Michigan State.
Goldman with the ball carry. He'll take it up to around the 39-yard line.
He also said, you know, he wants to be a spokesman for football, but he said sometimes people don't like to look and listen to fat guys that have an opinion, you know. But he said maybe Lavelle Edwards or Tom Osborne would be the spokesman. But he feels like that the presidents who are making the rules, they need a football coach involved because they know what's going on. They've been there. And some of these rules are being made without football coaches' input, and it's wrong.
Second down, Goldberg to the right side. And he'll be stopped at the 40-yard line. Cavallo is the man who makes the stop on him. Well, the Duracell, a halftime promo coming up here in less than a minute. News and notes from Miami. Sports Center update and also Cybill Shepherd's performance here at the 1993 Liberty Bowl. And with that, it is halftime in Memphis with our scores. They head to the locker room. The Spartans of Michigan State 7 and the Louisville Cardinals 3.
They've struggled in their last few bowls. Some early thoughts from you early in the week. Big picture for both teams, Coach.
Well, Mike, take it from Florida State situation. They got an outstanding offense. The one factor down here they must consider is the rain factor. There's a situation here where last year it rained 5 inches in this ball game, and it's a great neutralizer. But the most important thing they got to be careful for is the wind. Remember, they had a tough problem against Notre Dame and South Bend in the wind. Now Nebraska. To win, Nebraska has to play defense with their offense. By that, I mean they got to take the ball and ball control. First and 10, do it again. Keep Charlie Ward on the sideline. I think that situation could take it into the fourth quarter, gives them a chance to win, similar to a basketball team freezing the ball from a great team.
You talked about Charlie Ward. We're going to talk more about him as we continue with halftime here in Miami momentarily. But first, we want to get you up to date on what else is going on in the sports world on this Tuesday night. For that, back to our ESPN.
back with the second half in just a moment. But first, we're going to check in with Miami.
Turn into a fist fight here in the second half. Coach Howard Schnellenberger, viral pneumonia and all told his team, look, many times this year we've been in situations the other team on the other side of the ball had more talent, but our determination, our tenacity won the game for us. Expect to see that in the second half. Now, Michigan State and George Perlis going to keep the ball on the ground. They said ball control. We score a run up 200 yards per game. We usually win. The one exception this year, when they went 4-1 after running up 200 yards, they had 240 yards against Penn State. Of course, they're up by 20 and finally lost by one.
Okay, Adrian, good look at George Perlis right there. And let's take a look at the halftime stats.
Ron, just a complete domination by Michigan State. 13 first downs to 4. 7.9 average yards on first down. They've dominated on first down to Louisville's 3.1. And look at the time of possession. So, again, Howard Schnellenberger, Louisville, has to feel good about only being behind 7-3 with stats like that in the first half.
7-3 our score. As you take a look at Howard Schnellenberger, and the fact what Adrian was talking about is what I alluded to off the top of the telecast. He not only doesn't feel good, he doesn't feel good at all. If you got 102 fever, and he is very ill. But at halftime, talked with his charges about what has to happen. And on the other side of the field, when Michigan State took the floor of the Liberty Bowl to open the second half, they congregated out at the 40-yard line and held a quick pep rally themselves. So two emotion-ridden teams as we open the second half. Let's see if it pays off. David from the 5. Out to the 31-yard line, and it's Damian Manson who makes the stop, and it's a 26-yard return.
Ron, the other point is the fact that there hasn't been a turnover in this football game. Could be the decision-maker in who wins or loses this football game. A fumble, interception, block, kick, something to turn the tide of this game.
Now we'll see if Jeff Brohm was able to get warm after coming out of the locker room and throw the football and see if he can get something going for the Cardinals. They scored the first time they had the football tonight, and then it went dry after that. Pressure from behind, pass incomplete, as Glover is the man who was putting the pressure on.
Because of the injury of Jeff Brohm's finger, you see most of the throws are underneath 15 yards. One pass deep that was almost intercepted, and I'm sure Gary Nord, the offensive coordinator, when the ball was thrown like it was, decided to stay underneath with the passing game.
Brohm swings it out of the backfield. Dawkins, or check it, Fitzpatrick, takes it out to the 40-yard line, and it's going to be short of the first, but a third down at about a yard and a half as Henry comes over to make the stop on him.
Now they're going to a no-huddle offense, Ron, to try to make something happen on offense.
And let's check in quickly with Adrian.
During halftime, Jeff Brohm was squeezing a Nerf football in the locker room, Ron. Same thing he did after he had that initial operation, trying to get more mobility back in that injured hand.
Probably circulation as well, Adrian. We saw him exercising it down on the sideline, but he held it in front of the heater. There's a draw play coming out of that shotgun formation, and Dawkins will pick up the first down plus a couple as Juan Hammonds puts the stop on him.
Ron, that was a good move by Louisville. Howard Schnellenberger to go to the no huddle on third and short to not allow Michigan State a lot of time to get a substitution in the short yardage. And you can see now they're going to continue the no huddle. The reason for this is he's trying to generate some offense. He's trying to get his football team into a pace of picking it up a little bit on offense.
Again from the shotgun, pass over the middle, almost picked off by Fredrickson.
Went off the hand of Aaron Bailey. Aaron Bailey's from Michigan, didn't qualify because of the test score. Said if he would have qualified, he probably would have went to Michigan State, but instead he went to junior college, and here he's playing against Michigan State.
Real large, 5'10", 177, a senior out of Ann Arbor. Swings this one out of the backfield, and it is dropped by Fitzpatrick. And Chris is not happy with himself, but we have talked about the weather conditions here in Memphis tonight. At the halftime, we double-checked again. It is 31 degrees, and with the wind chill factor down just below 15, so it's damp, and it's a very cool night.
Ron, third down is Ralph Dawkins, Jamie Asher time, the tight end, number 37 and 22. Ralph Dawkins, he likes to go to them on third down.
Well, you could see the movement at the top of the screen by Bailey. And Brown is going to be sacked. Rich Glover, who has just been everywhere tonight for the Michigan State Spartans, makes the tackle behind the line of scrimmage, a loss of 12.
Red illegal procedure, offensive team, six men on the line of scrimmage. The penalty is declined.
Number 55, Rich Glover. He's going to get the pressure up the field on Jeff Brom. Working against Tom Carroll. Number 76 beats him, and Jeff Brom tries to work outside to scramble, but worked right to Rich Glover.
So Mike and the penalty, they didn't call the procedure, the 6 men at the line. They were calling the tackle being off the line of scrimmage.
And there was a player actually went downfield. I mean, yeah. Down before the snap of the ball.
Bailey moved before it was snapped. From the outside, Brookfield takes a long time to get that kick away. Fair catch called for and made by Coleman.
Good job! Nice job, Dale.
Been looking Glover down on the sideline. I mentioned that he just appears to have been everywhere tonight. In the first half, he was very strong and took it off the same way in the third quarter. Left in the third quarter, and Michigan State comes on for their first offensive series in this second half. Draw play to Craig Thomas.
Jim Miller's pass chart, and you look to the right, flat, short passes again, 5 out of 6 for Jim Miller. Again, a lot underneath. You see no throws over 15 yards. Both quarterbacks underneath passing game tonight.
Finally caught by Kevin Gaines.
Ball was played very badly by Anthony Bridges, number 21. He really took the bite and thought Milt Coleman was going to go outside after he made the catch. You see him shaking his head. Milt Coleman, number 6, working down the field. Now come back. Now Anthony Bridges guesses here and made and slips, falls down. Milt Coleman off to the races. Finally the tackle by Kevin Gaines.
33 yards in the pass play after the missed tackle, a total of the 33. Drop play to Golden. Tries to bounce it outside. 36, Ben Sumter is there to put a stopper on him.
Louisville's trying to bounce everything outside. You see Morris Watts there. He was coached at Tampa Bay in the NFL. He coached in the USFL, coached at the University of Kansas. Very experienced offensive coordinator. Was with Michigan State, left. George Perlis had a chance to bring him back. He had Ed Zombrecker working with the offense and moved Ed Zombrecker to coach linebackers so he could bring Morris Watts back. Very unselfish move by Ed Zombrecker to move over to defense so that they could bring Morris Watts back to the Michigan State.
Mike, the injured player for Louisville was linebacker Tom Cavallo, and he has come to the sideline. Came off under his own power and is standing on the sideline and possibly just waiting for the one play.
Scott.
So Miller wants a timeout. We'll take it with him. 11
backfield for Jim Miller.
Well, Second down for the Spartans. Good protection deep over the middle. Has a man. And incomplete as Outlaw couldn't hold on. Oh, my goodness.
Didn't come out in his break in time. Napoleon Outlaw, number 8, was open. You see both defensive backs, Darius Watson, number 43, Kevin Gaines, number 18, they busted that coverage, but Napoleon Outlaw did not come out of the break. Jim Miller with the throw. Has the deep throw, has Napoleon Outlaw open, but you see he came out of the break just a little bit too slow and just couldn't hold on to the football.
Third down for Michigan State. Pumps it under pressure, and he is going to be sacked. And again, the Louisville Cardinals coming up with the big play defensively as Joe Johnson and Leonard Ray are there to make the squeeze tackle on him.
Ron, now a decision for George Perlis because he's had problems with his field goal team. They missed one earlier. Fourth down and 16. Do you go for it? Do you bring the field goal kicker in, give him another shot? Or do you punt the football? He's going to punt the football, it looks like. Not enough confidence in his field goal team.
So Solani will come on, and Michigan State will, in fact, kick it away rather than go for the field goal. And that attempt would have been from around 47 yards. Hooch kick is going to hit in the end zone. And let's go down to the field and check in with Adrian again. Adrian.
Ron, a real interesting situation here. When Louisville's on offense, they use the footballs that they brought with them. Michigan State does the same thing. They use their balls. Because it's so cold down here, the balls are actually contracting. Jimmy Harper came over and just checked with the ball boys on the Louisville side here. The balls are not holding the regulation 13 pounds. The point is, with Jeff Brom and his injury, the ball with the deflated weight now is easier to grip. He may be able to increase his throwing ability here.
Could be a lot of hot air, too.
There's not much hot around the stadium tonight, Mike.
Now, what you like, Adrian's right, or what you like to do is keep the balls in the bag with a heater before you send them out there.
Shelman takes it off the right side for only one. Aaron Jackson is there to make the stop. Mike, is the reason we're not seeing more of Dawkins just because they're looking for the bigger back with Shelvin?
Good point, Ron. I think that is the reason, because they're Michigan State. You can't run against Michigan State with that tilt in there. They're having problems with it, so they're just trying to keep them honest, run inside every now and then, try to get Dawkins outside, try to get Shelman outside, but try to control this game and win it with the short passing game. Difficult when you can't throw deep.
9.5 minutes left in the third quarter. Spartans still lead it 7-3. Both teams scored. First time they had the football, and then we haven't seen anything since. Glover with pressure again. Pass over the middle is caught. Aaron Bailey breaks 1, 2, 3 tackles along the way, and he's down at the 37.
You know he has to feel good being from Michigan. Aaron Bailey, he dedicated this game tonight, the Liberty Bowl game, to Steve Hargrove, who was his best friend. He was supposed to come down to the game, but he was shot December 4th and was killed. And Aaron Bailey went back to Ann Arbor and was a pallbearer in the funeral. So he's dedicated this game tonight to his friend.
Joining Baylor now at the wide receiver, Mike, is Quali Cooper. He's a freshman out of Florence, Alabama, number 15. He played more as the year went on. Here comes Dawkins, and he does have the speed to turn the corner, and you see what happens. That's going to be a gain of over 10 yards in the play, and now some conversations about what Louisville thought was a late hit on the part of Stan Callender.
Aldi Henry, number 36, is complaining that he was held by Shelman, the back. You see number 36, he can't get off to make the play. Anthony Shelman was on him, Ralph Dawkins, for a big game. That's the play the strong safety, number 36, Aldi Henry, has to make. Has to turn it inside.
First down for the Cardinals at the 47-yard line, their own 47. It's to Shelman. This time they take it to the right, and Shelman is going to be hit. It's Juan Hammonds who catches him from behind.
And Louisville might pick up a hold here, Ron. There's a flag down on the play.
And the run, holding, offensive line, 10-yard penalty from spot of foul.
So Jimmy Harper says this time it's the Cardinals that are guilty of offensive holding, as the Spartans had three very big holding calls in that first 30 minutes of play, and now one against Louisville, and we'll see if they're able to overcome it. McKinney comes in replacing Aaron Bailey at wide receiver. Number 25 lines up at the top of your screen. Play action. Brom steps up and throws it complete. And here comes another flag in. And let's check in on, well, let's hold it right here for just a second. Jamie Asher made the catch. And let's see what the signal is.
It's going to be another hold.
We got holding. Offensive line during the play. 10 yards and spot a foul.
So Howard Snellenberger says, how? Two in a row. Well, this is the way it happens. Let's go down to the sideline and Adrian Carston with a very, very special guest. Adrian?
Ron, very special indeed. His senior season, 1954, which makes you how old at this point, Bill?
6-0.
There you are. let's compare the quarterbacks at this time. Johnny, the first time you've seen Jeff Brom play, people say he may be one of the top three quarterbacks taken in the draft.
Well, they played a pretty tough schedule this year, and he did very well. He threw up some good percentages and some touchdowns, and so far he's playing fairly well tonight with a bad finger.
The future of Louisville football, really the future is kind of based on the past and a lot of things that you accomplished there with a new stadium, playing bowl games now every other year.
Well, I think the program has done remarkably well. And Howard's done a great job with the program, and he's going out and got a new stadium, or got some money anyway to start a new stadium. I think the future looks very, very bright for the University of Louisville.
Ron, neither Jim Miller or Jeff Brom were wearing the high-top black shoes, but I think the haircut's coming back, Johnny. What do you think?
I think it is, too. A lot of kids in our area are getting that crew cut again.
Johnny, thanks for your time. Ron?
Welcome, baby. It's always great to see that face. Who could ever forget that game that probably put the National Football League on the map, the sudden death played against the Giants at Yankee Stadium, and the crowd coming on as Alan the Horse Amici scored. University of Wisconsin, his school. Johnny Unitas.
And I think the crew cut is back.
Shotgun formation on first school. Johnny Unitas.
And I think the crew cut is back.
Shotgun formation on first down. Brom, you saw him with the big run a moment ago. Throws it high, but it's gathered in by Ferguson. And then he picks up a few more, and all of a sudden, you get the feeling that Old Mo is beginning to shift over to the jerseys that are Cardinal in
color. And the big play in this drive, as you look at Johnny U again, was Jeff Brom running the football and picking up big yardage when it looked like he was going to be sacked. Here you see him out of the shotgun, looking for Reggie Ferguson. Ball's high. Reggie Ferguson really makes a good catch on it. Again, Ron, short passes. Ball's high. Good catch. Able to pick up the first down.
Line of scrimmage, the Michigan State 39. They go with the running play. Shelman off the handoff. Runs into and then over his own offensive lineman. And he was trying to get around 74, Garen Patrick, and got tripped up. Also, Juana Hammonds was there to get a hand on him. And you got to say, it's a gain of three.
Ron, Stanford had a back, Glenn Milburn, and I think Ralph Dawkins is the same type of back. Glenn Milburn's made it into pros. Here's Ralph Dawkins lining up at fullback. He blocks, he catches, he runs the football.
7-3, Michigan State leading. Brom, quick pass, and he hits him on the quick post. Paulie Cooper.
Got some zip on that football to Paulie Cooper. You just talked about him coming into the ball game, number 15. This was a design play with just one receiver. Good block by Ralph Dawkins. Jeff Brom right on the money. They're working on Demetrius Martin, number 12, who's the corner who was a receiver. Moved to cornerback.
Good for 13 yards in the last play. Here are his numbers. 11 of 18, 128 on the ball game. takes the time, throws it complete at the 20. That's Jamie Asher. And they're going to say that he got pushed out of bounds back around the 22, so he loses a couple. Henry defensively.
You know, Aaron Bailey has to be thinking, you know, I'm from Michigan. It'd be nice for me to catch one in that end zone against one of my home state schools. Number six, the wide receiver, looking for the big play.
He goes out to the right side, and above him is a 15, Pauly Cooper, top of your screen. Everybody in the pattern this time, and throws it complete at the 18 to Dawkins, and close to the first down at around the 13-yard line.
The reason Ralph Dawkins is so successful is when he catches the football, there's no jitterbugging with the ball. He is going north and south. He knows where the markers are. He knows he's going to try to make a move for the first down. He knew what he had to do once he caught the football.
You know, Mike, as they bring in the change from across the way, what a gutsy performance by Jeff Brom, and I don't think we can emphasize that enough. I think Johnny Unitas made the point, and it's well taken. Everybody's had to play with pain, but when you have to undergo surgery and you've got steel in your finger, literally, just so that you can play in the ballgame. You saw the run a minute ago. His teammates blocking like the Dickens for him because they don't want to see him get hit. They know that he is their meal ticket. And you really have to take care. I think a lot of quarterbacks might not have tried to come and play in this game.
I agree totally, Ron. You look at the selection so far, rushing 17 plays. Good mix by Louisville. Haven't been successful running the ball, just enough to keep the Michigan State defense honest.
Shellman hurdles, first down. Allen's down in the bottom of the stack, but it is a first and 10 for the Louisville Cardinals. Dawkins, by the way, Mike, 5 catches for 38 yards.
Key receiver, we talked about Jamie Asher, the tight end. They're the two receivers that their high percentage throws are to, and because of his injured hand tonight, Ralph Dawkins and Jamie Asher have to be the big play receivers for Louisville because they're the short passing game.
Over the middle, zings it just out beyond Aaron Bailey's fingertips. That was Martin who had the cover, but if it was about a foot shorter, it is a touchdown.
On that play, Jamie Asher was open over the middle. They may repeat this play and try to get it to Jamie Asher. Here's the throw to Aaron Bailey. Number 6 working against Demetrius Martin, number 12. Looked like he jumped just a little bit too soon, Ron. Didn't run through his route.
Mike,
he's up in the air too soon.
One of the things I think Louisville's going to have to be very, very careful of, and let's see how they line up. They got a call of 6 men at the line of scrimmage a moment ago. Well, this time the tackles are in tight, but they're cheating a little bit. Now a timeout called by Louisville. Only the second time that they have had the ball inside the Michigan State 20.
That's my best guess down here that you're going to look for one of two receivers. Number 37, the tight end Asher. Are you going to try to find the back out of the backfield? And Ralph Dawkins.
Brown, no place to run, and he's going to be sacked, and that's Reggie Garnett. Third sack by Michigan State, and of all the things you didn't want to happen, that's it right there.
You're right, Ron. The true freshman, Reggie Garnett, number 22. He's from Akron, Ohio. And when Norm Parker, the defensive coordinator for Michigan State, recruited this freshman linebacker, he thought he could be the starter. He said, because of the length of the season and the size of the players that you're not used to in high school football, he's worn down a little bit. But with the rest, he figured, George Perlis figured that he'd have a good ball game tonight.
Only a freshman. Third down. They can pick up a first down without scoring, but they have to take it all the way to the 1 yard line. And they didn't get it away. That's going to be a delay of game against the Louisville Cardinals.
Dead ball, delay of game, offensive team, 5 yards.
Yeah. Howard Snellenberger has to be thinking, what else can happen this day? I was awakened at the quarter of six with a false fire alarm and had to leave my hotel room. I got 102 degree fever, a viral pneumonia is what it has been described as. And now this half, we've had a couple of holding calls, and down here knocking on the door, I get sacked, and then I get caught by the 25-second clock.
Well, if he can get one touchdown pass to the end zone, that temperature will drop to 98.
Situation 4:11 left in the third quarter. Spartans leading 7-3.
You have to figure they're going to try to throw to the end zone, and Demetrius Martin, number 12.
Coming on, Ronnie's going to run it.
20 at the 15, gets a block and steps out of bounds just shy of the 5-yard line.
Good pressure again by Michigan State. Juan Hammonds, 89. They're just beating the blocks of the offensive tackle, and you see Juan Hammonds is down.
That's 18 yards in the scramble. And now the decision for Louisville, and it's no longer a decision, as Akers comes on, and Louisville will be going for the field goal.
No decision at all, Ron, because the way the offense is tailed off, you're looking at three field goals to take the lead, and two more, 3-7-3 now. If your defense can continue to hold Michigan State, David Akers could be the key to this ball game.
Well, Juan Hammonds, we're happy to report, is up and is heading off the field. They're helping him, but he's coming off under his own power. Boy, has he ever played well. And a man over at the other side, and a defensive end as well, Rich Glover. But the two defensive ends have really, really been present this evening.
I agree. David Akers is out of Lexington. Tate Creek played for Roy Walton, a very successful high school coach who I just believe just retired.
23-yard attempt. Marty Lowe in the ball game to handle the hold. Akers, the left footer, had the perfect angle, and he just missed it. Good heavens, from point blank range. So as we go to break, take a look at the head coach on the sideline, and here's how he reacted. Here, Kozar puts the Canes out in front, but Nebraska storms back, down 31-30. A pass for a two-point conversion. It was knocked away, and Snellenberger won the national championship. And right now, he would do most anything for that field goal that he missed just a moment ago.
And people talk about how close you come. Tom Osborne, who's had a great career at Nebraska, they were close in that ball game, and one pass away, and how can you criticize anybody for not winning a national title? Only unbelievable record in Nebraska.
Craig Thomas. Boy, he gets cracked hard as he takes it to the 25. Adrian Karsten, what do you have for us?
Ron, after looking at that video, interesting to realize there are eight other coaches besides Coach Snellenberger still active with one national titles. Coach Majors when he was at Pitt in 1976. Danny Ford won at Clemson. He's, of course, now at Arkansas. Lavelle Edwards won the national title at BYU in 84 and Joe Paterno in 82 and 86. And then, of course, in 1988, Lou Holtz beat West Virginia in the Fiesta Bowl. Dennis Erickson, two national titles in his first 4 years. Coach McCartney at Colorado in 1990. And Gene Stallings last year in 1992.
All right, Adrian. Counterplay. This will be good for the first down as they bring it out over the right side to around the 31-yard line. By the way, that last Louisville drive, 14 plays, 74 yards, 6:13 off the clock, and no points.
That's the big thing, no points.
Everything until that last line that I read is the way you want it to happen.
But you have to, and you look at the place kicker here, David Akers, you just gotta have to make those field goals. Now it looks like hammer time for Michigan State. George Perlis is saying, hey, we're gonna hammer this football.
Just under 3 minutes to play, third quarter. Fred is caught just short of the of the 50-yard line is Milt Coleman. And Mike, I was beginning to wonder if Bryce Abrams might draw a flag back there because he was like a whirling dervish. And I wonder about the shoulders adjacent to the line of scrimmage or exactly how you have to wind up before the ball is snapped.
I think he's okay. He's behind. He's in motion. And a good route by Milt Coleman there. You know, he was a quarterback out of high school. Michigan State gave him a chance to be the quarterback. He didn't make it. He moved out to the wide receiver position unselfishly. He's the best wide receiver that Michigan State has.
Goldberg. Sumter comes over to make the tackle, and Louisville has Anthony Bridges shaken up in the play, and if you look at the replay again, you'll see why, because he got stacked on late by an offensive lineman, and he was not looking for that. I don't know what the nature of the injury is, but Bridges wanted a flag to come flying, and he didn't get it. Okay, watch what happens here. He is to the right of the screen, and he's down, and then you see the big offensive lineman. Laureus comes in there after the play is over, and here's a second look at it right here.
Brett Laureus is 6'4", 304 pounds, yelling, "Timber, here I come," right in his head.
And you can see the Bridges already had locked headgears with his teammate as they missed the ball carrier and hit each other. And then Laureus came in and added insult to injury, and as a result, he is down. Well, College Game Day takes a look at the Orange Bowl matchup between Florida State and Nebraska, and their coach is looking for their first national championship, Bobby Bowden, and of course Tom Osborne. And also, you look at Bridges coming off the field, and obviously he's gonna be on that bench for a couple of plays. This is Goldberg. Hard at the line of scrimmage. Joe Johnson, number 94, is the man who came across first, and the big junior from St. Louis causes that play to go for a loss. And now a third down for Michigan State, and they don't want this thing to stymie right here. They'd like to carry it right on through into the fourth quarter.
You also now figure with Anthony Bridges out of the ball game, Sam Madison's his backup, number 13. Do you put Milt Coleman on Sam Madison, try to get him open versus the new corner? We'll see what George Perlis decides to do.
And also, if you're Howard Schnellenberger, do you make sure that the new kid on the block has got help over there? Well, there's a good look at Carter, the freshman out of Coconut Creek, Florida. Intercepted. Frost, Johnny Frost is the man who cut in front, a sophomore out of Opelika, Florida, and McLeod had a second chance at it.
It's his kind of weather. Johnny Frost should have had the interception. It was thrown right to him, but again, a nice series by the Louisville defense. Gave up some yardage, but didn't give up the big play. Ty Smith, the defensive coordinator, has to feel good about the way his defense is responding.
Louisville with 10 men at the line of scrimmage. Will they come after Solani, or do they have the return on? They're coming after him. Not his best kick. Bailey from the 16. Bailey all the way back to the 40-yard line. 31 yards on the return.
Excuse me, Ron. Picked up a good block by Johnny Frost, number 56. He missed the interception, but he came back with a good block for Bailey. Aaron Bailey, the Michigan kid, trying to make it happen.
Boy, he was within one, and Glover, who has done such a great job on the defensive front, is the man who made what could have been a touchdown-saving tackle.
You talked about something a little earlier, the Michigan State defense. When you watch the Penn State game, Norm Parker, the defense coordinator, said to me, if Louisville watched that film, and I know they did, they're going to try to throw deep on us because we just lost a 20-point lead. But you got to credit Norm Parker tonight for the job this defense is doing for Michigan State.
Sets, zings it into the flat, and as you can see, the receiver Asher falls down after making the reception. It'll be a gain of close to five.
In talking to all the Michigan State players that we talked to while we're here, and the coaches, They said the game that they had a hard time getting over was that Penn State game. Yeah. They blew the 20-point lead, and then they said we went to Japan and we played Wisconsin. We didn't have anything to play for, and that's no excuse. We couldn't move up in the standings. We weren't going to a different bowl game. Obviously, it's a game you still have to play, but the motivation wasn't there for them because the Penn State game took a lot out of this football team.
Shulman turns the corner and is going to have the Louisville first down. 3-2 now. They have stopped the clock momentarily for the move into the chain, and that'll be the last play unless they called him out of bounds. It'll be the final play of that third quarter.
Another key block by Ralph Dawkins, number 22.
And they whistle it back in, and we head to the final 15 minutes here at the 35th Liberty Bowl. We'll be right back. They have not scored since. And actually, why did these two offenses settle in? As you see the numbers and what I was talking about, no scoring.
I think good defense. I think the fact Jeff Brohm's injury has hampered Louisville because they have not been able to throw the ball deep. Michigan State stopped themselves on offense. I don't think it's a weather condition. I think it's a fact of good defenses and both offenses stopping each other. And, Ron, Louisville's going to have to take a shot. I know Jeff Brohm's hurt. He's got his fingers hurt. But this is the time, the best time, to take the long ball shot right here. You're
on this
across
down.
The 50-yard line, first down, send it downfield and try to serve notice.
Make the running play. Bootleg. Hammond is right there, and he would not be fooled. That is a fine defensive play.
Juan Hammond's talked about Bailey being from Michigan. Juan Hammond's is from Louisville. Come in as he came to Michigan State as a linebacker. Read the play from the snap of the ball. Was not faked out by Jeff Brohm's good fake in the backfield.
You hear that old expression of staying at home. There's a very good example of him carrying out his assignment first and then to see where the play might have gone had the quarterback handed it off. So on second down and long, Brohm going to go on top. Nope, right over the middle. Throws it complete to Dawkins, and Dawkins fights his way to the 40-yard line. And now for Louisville, here's the situation. It's going to be a third down and four. Fredrickson and Garnett combining in the stop.
When you not only the injury to Jeff Brohm, as you see Howard Snellenberger getting a call from upstairs to Gary Nord, but the fact he hasn't practiced. When he was hurt the last game of the year against Tulsa, he sat out. He didn't really start throwing the football until they arrived here in Memphis. Steady. So not only the fact he's hurt, Ron, he's rusty. Took a long time to get rid of that football.
Line to make, as we said, the 36. Looking. Gets it complete, and that'll be the first down at the 30, and it's Ralph Dawkins. They took him out of the backfield, got the completion, and it's down to the 29.
Ralph Dawkins really made this play because he's working against Ricardo Jackson, number 25. Jeff Brohm first looking downfield, nose on third down. He can always find Ralph Dawkins because he's working. There's the fingers, Ron. That's what he's throwing with tonight. And as you said earlier, a gutty performance.
Oh, I think the young man, just a lot of quarterbacks would have said, no, folks, I'm going to watch this one from the sideline. But
how about the press box? A little warmer up there.
From 8 of his last 9, first down for the Cardinals. Quick out and incomplete, and probably a good thing that it was not complete because Fitzpatrick just was very vulnerable to being taken apart by Albie Henry.
To me, watching Jeff Brohm, having watched the tapes and having, we had him against Texas A&M, we've had him a couple times, he's making mistakes tonight, throwing into coverage, things he didn't do during the regular season. And again, I have to point to the fact that the layoff has hurt him.
Mike, I think the man that you were talking about, Bailey, and getting him involved, I think Dawkins is a guy, just like the catch he made a moment ago in the big third down play. I think he's got to be more involved for them to be successful offensively. Pumps it once. Boy, great protection. Now he's going to run it, and we'll take it down to the 25-yard line, Aaron Jackson. And I want to show you a picture of what happened on the play here, Mike. You see him get up and look at his fingers. There's Bailey as he comes back and being chatted with by Callender. Take a look at Dawkins.
Ralph Dawkins working down the field. Now the linebacker's on him, Reggie Garnett. Safety's going to pick him up. Demetrius Martin, number 12. Of course, the ball late if Jeff Brom, under a rush, could have had some time, he would have found Ralph Dawkins, but a good pressure by Michigan State.
Brom wanted it over the middle, now delivers. He's got his man open at the 10, at the 5, touchdown Reggie Ferguson.
What made that play was Ralph Dawkins. Underneath, everybody and their brother thought he was going to Ralph Dawkins. He pumped the football, but then he was able to bring it back, see Reggie Ferguson wide open about 10 yards behind Ralph Dawkins for the touchdown. And I'm telling you, I've said it, we've said it, you said it, I'm impressed with Jeff Brom. You just can't say enough about the effort he's given.
His ability and particularly his heart. 12:05 left to play in the ball game. 9-7, extra point attempt is good by Akers, and we have a 3-point lead for the Louisville Cardinals. Let's take a break. Back to Memphis in just a moment. Jeff Brom going down the sideline. The last person he was talking to was his center, Jason Stinson, but making sure that the offensive linemen are thanked for the job that they did, because without the protection, it wouldn't have happened, Mike.
Good protection on that play, and that's the job of the quarterback to begin to continually compliment his offensive line, because you're right, it doesn't happen unless you have time to throw the football.
So Akers will kick it off. Mason and Green, the two deep backs, and he's going to put it on the ground. A swift kick. It's Kuhn who will take it back across the 35.
How does a player affect coverage? Ralph Dawkins. He's going to work downfield on this play. Both linebackers, Fredrickson, number 83, will pick him up first, and Reggie Garnett, number 22. Freeze it. Behind him now is Reggie Ferguson, number 3, coming into the picture. But because of the underneath coverage has disappeared, he's wide open. And then it's a sprint to the end zone.
And, Mike, it goes back to what we were talking about. All of a sudden, Dawkins, because he made a couple of things happen, he drew their attention.
Makes things happen. I'm impressed with Ralph Dawkins. Jeff Brom, good protection.
So the Spartans get the ball back in very good field position. Miller up the sideline, and it's going to be picked off. Number 43, Watson. And he will take it all the way back to the 33.
The only mistake Darius Watson made, he should have stayed down the sideline. But the interception's big. Jim Miller got a little impatient here for Michigan State, because you're only down 10-7. Louisville got him into a situation in two deep coverage. Here's 43 sitting on the hash. He's just going to work back here. He's reading Jim Miller all the way. He's got the deep route. Jim Miller thinks it's open, but there comes number 43, Darius Watson, for the interception. But he should have stayed down the sideline. That's where his convoy was.
Looks like Mill Coleman also had fallen down out there, Mike. Going to go on top. On first down, incomplete. Heck of an effort by Reggie Ferguson, but he couldn't hold on. By the way, before we forget, that last drive, 7 plays, 59 yards, 3 minutes and 38 seconds, and the 25-yard touchdown pass, Brom to Ferguson.
Norm Parker, the defensive coordinator, has done a good job for Michigan State. See Norm right there. The injury to Wozlik early, the 2 games remaining, really hurt them and forced them to move Myron Bell to free safety, number 24, so he's kind of patched this defense together.
Well, an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty against Michigan State, and this penalty is going to be assessed all the way down inside the 20-yard line. And right now, the Spartans have got to come up big with 11:38 left in the ball game. They cannot allow Louisville to punch a second quick touchdown in here.
Toss sweep or trap play inside, using Dawkins and Shelvin in this particular set. Try to get outside with Dawkins here.
see him change and go to the tilt. The pitch goes to Dawkins, turns the corner, runs into and over the defensive back as Callender came up. And let's go down to the sideline at Adrian Karstad. Adrian.
Ron, yeah, Ron, after that last touchdown, I was in just feet of Coach Snellenberger. He indicated he wanted to go for two, if you can believe it. In the last second, either he talked himself out of it or the assistant coaches did. Now, had they converted on a two-point conversion, would have made the score 11-7. Obviously, MSU would have had to score the touchdown to go ahead, but boy, that's showing a lot of confidence in the defense, but they did just that, came up with the interception.
I think they made the right call. You go for the point, 10-7, you're back down here again. You need to score again, and Shellman, number 29, DI now, pound him inside.
The I formation, and just what Mike said, there's Shelvin. He will have the first down. It is first and goal for the Louisville Cardinals as Myron Bell comes up to make the stop. The thing that surprises me is the card, the chart that is kept on the sideline. That would not call for support.
No. It's a one-point situation, but when you're a gambler sometimes, you gamble sometimes in a ball game. But now Louisville has Shelvin inside. They have Dawkins outside, and now you have the play fake possibility with Jeff Brown for the touchdown pass here. I think they'll try to keep it on the ground with Shellman.
First and goal from the five. That's where they go. Shellman hit in the backfield, and who else? Juan Hammonds. Hammonds and Glover have been the two mainstays defensively. Garnett also helping out.
Now, Ron, you're forced to a second down situation. The play action with Jeff Brown here now. Norm Park with a good call. He felt the same thing I did. Anthony Shellman's going to carry the ball. Gary Nord made the play call. Norm Parker with a good defense. Puts him in a second and six situation.
Mike, I was just mentioning the outstanding performance by Hammonds and also Glover. Coming up at the end of the telecast tonight, we will name our Isuzu players of the game. And, of course, those two guys from Michigan State certainly top candidates for the games that they have had. Second down from the five. Throws it to the end zone. Dawkins can't hold on, and the ball stayed in the air as Fredrickson was trying to make the play on it, and you could see that there was almost an opportunity for Garnett to come over and make an interception.
Ron, I'd come right back with the same play. I'd go right back to Ralph Dawkins. Ralph Dawkins, when that play was over, was yelling at the sideline to Howard Snellenberger something of maybe I made a mistake, maybe I should get out of the break a little sooner. I'd come right back with the same thing to Ralph Dawkins. He was open. Ball thrown just a little late.
10-7. The Cards lead it. They have a third down and goal at the Michigan State 5. They roll the pocket. Pressure coming on Brown. Now he's got to get rid of it. He can't get sacked here. Going to run for the sideline. Now throws it away. And caught by Asher at the 1 yard line. Oh, my goodness.
What a play by Jeff Brown. Jamie Asher was coming back. He was actually in the end zone when the ball was thrown, and he came out of the end zone. Now it's decision time for Howard. He's going for the touchdown. No decision. Jeff Brown just ran all around. Now, the one thing you don't want here is an interception.
Yeah.
You don't want to take away your points, but he saw his tight end, Jamie Asher. What made him, the ball was thrown behind him, made him come out of the end zone.
The other thing you didn't want besides the intercept, you didn't want to be sacked or to run out of bounds way back at the 20.
I think I'd take a timeout here. This is a big play in the ball game. I'm going to make sure I've got my best football play.
And they are going to take a timeout with a fourth down and one.
He is a play action fake to Shellman. Roll out Jeff Brown. Here they come out in the eye. There's Anthony Shellman over the top or a roll out with the fake.
What a job by the Michigan State defense. Bell, one of the first men. And Organic as well, coming across to make the hit. And he doesn't get into the end zone.
Didn't give him a chance to get airborne because they beat him in the line of scrimmage. Brett Organic, number 91, was the player that got underneath. When you don't win the line of scrimmage here, you don't give your back a chance. Number 22, Reggie Garnett with a big play, the freshman middle linebacker. I still think that was a good call by Art Snellenberger, not going for the field goal. And now you let your defense play. If they can go 99 yards on you, they deserve to beat you.
Little lining up in his own end zone, but happy to do so because of the circumstances, and there is a safety. Good heavens, Joe Johnson with the huge play, and Louisville comes up with 2 points.
Something was wrong with that play. From the start, it looked like a missed play in the backfield because he either stumbled coming out of his stance or it was some type of delay. It looks like he stumbled because he never really got a chance to get going. Number 33, Craig Thomas, starts, see the little slip, and then he's trying to bend it back. You can't bend the play back there. Joe Johnson, number 94, was able to go inside the block and beat the block. Number 94, look at him go inside number 99. Bob Denton beat him, and he was in on the play.
You also could see his quarterback looking for a different handoff spot, and the running back was not there.
You always like to have a lead blocker in that situation, so you at least get somebody up there to pump it before the back gets there. But went with a one-back situation. Craig Thomas slipped, and now it's a 2 point. So, again, let's go back to Howard Snellenberger's decision. A good decision because he was playing field position. I'm going for the touchdown to try to put a stake in their heart. If I don't get the touchdown, then I at least leave the football down on the one-yard line. George Perlis has to get it out of there. So now we get a safety. Now Louisville should get good field position. They'll probably punt the football here. Louisville should be back down. When you're an independent football team like Louisville, they need this bowl win. They're trying to make a statement with the coalition. They don't like the coalition. I don't like the coalition. They rule them out. Now there's 80 teams across America that's meeting around to try to have a super conference. If they do that, teams like Louisville, Memphis State, Cincinnati, they don't get a chance to play East Carolina. That's wrong.
Jelani with the punt, and a not a very long punt. Going to go out of bounds just across the 50-yard line. Well, coming up, the Thrifty Car Rental Bowl Week, and it continues on ESPN tomorrow. The Weiserlack Copper Bowl, Wyoming takes on Kansas State. Then let's take a look at Thursday, the Thrifty Car Rental Holiday Bowl. BYU against number 11, Ohio State. How about a triple header on Friday? The Independence Bowl will go from Shreveport, then to Atlanta, and we'll finish it up in the Alamo in San Antonio for the Alamo Bowl. Then number 23, Michigan against North Carolina State on New Year's morning. All right here on ESPN.
That's a mouthful. Do you agree with me on these 80 teams are meeting the big conferences across the country, and they want to have this football thing where there's just 80 teams? And to me, this coalition, all this thing, hurts a team like Louisville. It hurts the chance to play in the best bowl. It hurts them in the chance for the national championship. This team went to the Fiesta Bowl a couple years ago and beat Alabama.
And beat them very badly.
Yeah, I mean, don't rule out a team with a chance to play. That's wrong.
Well, it's like George Perlis said yesterday, that he said if this team played in a conference, they would get a lot more respect than they do. Pitch goes to Dawkins. And he is downed after a gain of 3. By the way, we spoke with Coach Snellenberger on his biggest disappointment in the coalition.
Pointed this thing, it doesn't make any difference what our record is, and we're playing in the Liberty Bowl. The problem is a lot deeper than that. When we start next year, if everything stays the way it is, the kids that I brought in 4 years ago, 5 years ago, and promised them that we would compete for the national championship, that's not a truism.
And of course, the point is well taken, is just what Mike is saying. The fact that because of the circumstances, and particularly now we go a step further as far as having an elite 80, so to speak, then Louisville certainly will not get an opportunity to play for the national championship.
I know you're good in football and what you do, and you also do college basketball. In college basketball, Division I teams all have a dream of the tournament, the national championship, all the things. They're trying to change this in football, and it's wrong. They're trying to change it so that only 80 get a chance. They're trying to do with this coalition that these conferences, Big Ten gets 5 spots, the Southeastern Conference gets so many spots. And I'm not, they're good conferences, but let the independents live. Help them out a little bit.
There certainly needs to be a spot for them. 8:42 left in this 35th Liberty Bowl game. The Cardinals of Louisville leading by 5 points, 12-7, following a field goal, then a touchdown, and now a safety. And they have the football at the 48-yard line. Ball is dumped off to Dawkins. Gets one block, turns it upfield, and he will go inside the 45, and on that second effort, may have just picked up the first down. Aaron Jackson puts a stopper on him, also Fredrickson.
You're looking at Glenn Milburn. You're looking at Eric Metcalf, the same type of player in Ralph Dawkins, and a good tackle by Rob Fredrickson, number 83. 8 receptions, 66 yards. But it's the other things that help him. The blocking, the running the football, the decoy. They're going to miss him at the University of Louisville.
Under 8 minutes to play in this Liberty Bowl game. Actually, the weather has not been the factor that we thought it would be. The field actually has held up extremely well. It's just very cold, but these two teams are accustomed to that, particularly Michigan State. Shellman, deep in the eye, he gets the handoff. Fumbles the football, recovered by Michigan State. Or did it come out? Henry came down on top of it, and then they continued to fight for the football. And Louisville took the football away. He couldn't hold on to it.
I'll tell you what, that had to slip right out of Aldi Henry. And look at Howard shaking his head. Temperature just went down 2 degrees.
Let's take a look at it from a low angle, Mike, to see exactly what happened. Looked Shellman
like,
got it.
Looked like 70, number 76. Ball stripped right there.
It
now
went right on through.
Right on through.
Shellman probably scared to death because of his error. Followed, it's like in basketball, following your shot, follow your fumble.
He's not only scared of his air, he's scared of that man with 103 degree temperature.
So it is a first down with the run, the fumble, the missed recovery by Michigan State, and now the ball at the 33. Six, and let's see, they're going to spot him down at the 28. Demetrius Martin makes the stop on him, and it's going to be a second down and short for the Louisville Cardinals.
Gary Nord told me about Anthony Shellman. He said he could be an All-American if he was playing in an eye attack, a running attack. He's a tall, wiry, fast running back. And I like what Gary Nord and Howard Snellenberger did. He fumbled the ball in the previous play, came right back and gave it to him again. Confidence. Players need confidence. When they see it from their coaches and the way they call the game, they know they can deliver. There's a sweep right here with Dawkins.
Dawkins on the draw. 5-10, high-stepping, and he'll have almost 15 yards in the play as Bell came up to hit him, and he was determined to get that extra 2 or 3. Boy, take a look at it from down on the field.
You're talking about high-stepping. Jason Stinson, the center, with a good block. Sean Kreese, number 68, with a good block. Good hit by Myron Bell, number 24. Big play for the Louisville offense.
17 yards and a carry by Dawkins.
Michigan State has to hold them to at least a field goal here. Cannot let him in the end zone.
As you can see, the clock on the lower right-hand side, under 6 minutes to play now. Shellman. Going to be close to 5. Henry comes up from his strong safety position. And now with every glance to the field and then back to the clock by both coaches to see what they have to work with. Schnellenberger would like to see this drive take actually 5.5 more minutes. He could get points, wonderful, but as long as he's got the ball, Spartans can't do anything about it to put points of their own up there.
Michigan State has 2 timeouts left. Louisville has 1 timeout. George Perlis on the sideline will make his decision when he needs to start using his timeouts. Here's where it may be a sweep with Dawkins or the trap up inside.
Let it go with the pitch. Mike, you're going to come outside. Down Ralph Dawkins. And Shellman with a paving block.
23. Worked him inside, Ron, with Shellman. Worked him outside with Dawkins. Trapped Dawkins up inside. That was, he gave a lot of credit to the Louisville offensive line there because they did that on the ground. That was a ground drive. Can breathe a little easier, but there's still 4:57 on the clock.
A Lakers to attempt the extra point. Fumbled snap, pressure, and they're going to be trapped behind the line of scrimmage, and the one-point conversion is no good. So let's take a break. 4:57 left in this 35th. Liberty ball, as you're saying, not so soon, guys.
They better not celebrate too soon. Michigan State can still put a drive together, two-point play, and you're back in this thing.
Well, when you got a guy like Mill Coleman, he can stick it in the end zone as quickly as any of the wideouts for Louisville. So you don't want to pop the cork too quickly. His kickoff. It's going to be short again. It'll come down to Green at the 12.
But it makes the touchdown plays. You see Matt Christensen, number 45. He's going to work up the field. But Clarence or Anthony Shellman is going to come out here and make the block on him, the tailback. Here's number 29. There's the block. Now Ralph Dawkins is to the corner. And he's high-stepping in the end zone.
As you look at Howard Schnellenberger, the total plays in the second half. Look at this. You talk about a reversal. 14 plays for Michigan State, 43 for the Louisville Cardinals, and total yards in the second half, 209 to 93. Pass, he's caught. Mill Coleman going to be knocked out of bounds on the near sideline. Let me change it. In the second half, Michigan State, 61 total yards in the second half for Louisville, 235. Tonight, by the way, I know there are 3,000 Louisville fans who are watching this game tonight. That what they got caught in the snow.
Caught in the snow in Bowling Green, Kentucky. So they're in hotels cheering for their ball club tonight.
And I imagine that that celebration is kind of going strong. Green with a nice move. He'll be hit and finally knocked out of bounds by McLeod. Clock is stopped with 4:33 to play in this 35th Liberty Bowl Classic.
One of the benefits not only of going to a bowl game do you play the game, but also it's a chance when you have a team like Michigan State, who's a young team, to practice your young players. It's like an extra spring practice round because you get your 20-some practice sessions, so you not only practice for the game, but you keep your younger players out after practice, and it's an extra spring practice, a bonus.
Pass caught by Coleman over the middle. And let's go down to Adrian Karsten.
Ron, quick thought about Mill the Thrill Coleman. He could have gone to Michigan, could have gone to Colorado. Ron, I'll let you call the play here. Make my point when you're done. Actually, the point is, he came from Farmington Hills Hanson High School in Michigan, came as a quarterback, threw for 7,000 yards. Remember, he could be the quarterback here next year.
Pass is thrown complete to Scott Green. Adrian, that is something I think that his head coach, George Perlis, made very, very obvious when he visited with all of us yesterday. And that is, if things don't work out for other folks who are in that position, that we'll see number six at the helm at Michigan State next year.
And Mill Coleman went to Michigan State's quarterback camp since he was 13 years old.
Pass is tipped. Incomplete, as Coleman is the man they wanted. And McLeod is the Louisville Cardinal who had the cover.
They're recruiting, got two really good freshman quarterbacks at Michigan State, so there'll be some competition at that quarterback position. They're recruiting some players out there, talking to Morris Watts. He feels pretty good that George Perlis is going to land some good quarterbacks, and there's some good quarterbacks on campus. But Mill Coleman could make that switch.
Well, the situation right now is 3:43 left in this ballgame, and Michigan State with the football at the Louisville 36-yard line. Miller on third down, zings it, incomplete, wanted outlaw, and now it'll bring up fourth down.
Morris Watts, the offensive coordinator, as you see Jim Miller taking the fault for that pass. Need the first down, but he also has to be thinking of his two-point play call if he scores a touchdown, because it'll make it, they'll be down by five. The two-point play, if they could make it, would make it a three-point game, and then you're onside kicking to try to get back in this game at the end. So they're not out of it by a long stretch.
Well, right now, the first thing first, Mike. Fourth down, they got to pick up six to keep it alive. Miller's pass is intercepted, didn't drop. Darius Watson had it and then dropped it and actually picks up yards by doing it. And Louisville takes it over with 3.5 minutes on the clock.
Your point's well taken. Good move. Dropped the football. I don't know if he dropped it on purpose, but they get better field position. Jim Miller just overthrows the receiver. Too far out. Ball just dropped by number 43, Darius Watson. Now it's Shellman and Dawkins time to run the football and kill the clock. Well, George has been, George Perlis is an outspoken coach at Michigan State, and there aren't many coaches that stay at one institution a long period of time. I mean, people get bored with it. But George has been able to stay at Michigan State. He's done a nice job there for the Spartans.
Straight ahead with the running play. They'll take it for a couple. Spartans still have two timeouts left. And we'll see when they start using them. There is a whistle. A timeout has been called. And it looks as though Michigan State has used ones that are not there as far as what he forced. And Jeff Brohm, what an outing for him. 217 total yards and one touchdown. And the difference in his ball game is not only his passing, but the rushing game really helped him with his passing. And Jeff Brohm, what an outing for him. 217 total yards and one touchdown. And the difference in his ball game is not only his passing, but the rushing game really helped him with his passing game in the second half, because Louisville rushed for 17 in the first half, 113 in the second half, and one of the reasons that the passing game went a lot smoother. Brohm with a gutsy performance, though. Going to roll the pocket. He's just going to carry this thing. He's going to be hit and knocked down hard by Fredrickson at the 43-yard line.
I think he fumbled the football, Ron. Think they're calling it down.
Mm-hmm.
Break for Jeff Brohm. Statement for Louisville tonight. When you commissioners, Big Ten commissioner and SEC commissioner out there trying to get decide that 80 team, don't leave these other guys out. They made a statement tonight.
So let's take a timeout. 3:06 left in the ballgame. Now they go at Kentucky, at Boston College, at home, at Arizona State, Texas on the road, Pitts at home, NC State is at home, at Army, at Navy, and then they finish on the road. Memphis State, Texas A&M, and Tulsa. Dawkins breaks one, two, three, and four tackles, and all the way down to the 26-yard line. Myron Bell finally stops him.
You remember your last college football game, and Ralph Dawkins is going to remember his. What a performance by Ralph Dawkins tonight. Knows he doesn't want to go out of bounds to stop the clock, stays up inside, breaks some tackles. Aldi Henry, number 36, Myron Bell, number 24, finally makes the tackle.
Look at these numbers on Dawkins for this evening. That rush right there is good for 32 yards. 87 rushing, 66 receiving. His footing there as he tries to turn the corner. But just like all good running backs, you get a good lather and they just keep wanting the football. Just keep on pumping it away. About to go under 2 minutes left in his 35th Liberty Bowl game. And the Louisville Cardinals 18-7 leading over the Spartans of Michigan State.
Ron, Michigan State's a very young football team. They'll contend next year for the Big Ten championship under George Perlis. This was a year. A lot of youth in their lineup. They've played a lot of freshmen. They'll be back next year and back strong in the Big Ten.
Well, SportsCenter coming up next, the Rockets and the Sonics. What a showdown in the NBA. Also, Indiana against Western Kentucky. And Lou Holtz. I have no idea what that means.
No, and Ralph Willard taking on Bobby Knight tonight in that basketball game. Mm-hmm. So that'll be an interesting game. Western Kentucky's got it going.
Yeah. Western Kentucky, Ralph's done a really good job there.
He really has. And the former assistant, Rick Pitino, the Hoosier Classic. I don't think Indiana's ever lost that.
Under a minute to play. Dawkins takes this one straight ahead, and with Michigan State unable to stop the clock, about one more snap, and that's going to do it. 25-second clock has just been whistled in, so they'll have to either go to a knee or run one more play, and this one is history.
Just roll out or a toss sweep should kill it, and Howard Snellenberger remains undefeated in bowl games.
Nils Schellman, and he will carry it, go down, and that's it. The crowd counts it down, but in the second half, that really was the difference. His wife, Beverly, is joining down on the sidelines.
She wants the Gatorade, too.
Well, I'll tell you, where she's standing, she's going to get it. I hope that mink coat cleans easy.
Hey, you'll take the Gatorade on the mink coat for a victory in the Liberty Bowl.
Well, I just wonder if the guys will have the guts to do it with her standing right next to him.
Only the seniors, because they're not coming back.
You wouldn't do that to a coach who had 102 fever, would you?
Yes.
Well, nope. Jimmy Harper says, roll the clock.
Jimmy's seen enough. 1 second left, and they're going to make him run one more play. Right now, Jimmy Harper is mad at the timekeeper. They're playing without a football. They don't have a football out there. We need a football to finish this ball.
A special thanks to our friends here at KHNL Television here in Honolulu for that music video, and a special welcome to our viewers that now are aboard on Prime Ticket. And Terry, we talk about a couple of big centers in Osborne. And we are underway, and the Rainbows chase it down in the backcourt. And Kalia McGee, the junior out of Honolulu, actually a couple of hometown products from the Hawaiian Islands, did the damage against Evansville for the Bows last night.
Louisville in their traditional man-to-man, they'll switch. And someone lost Bonner down low, and down they got a break that time.
And Osborne got the block. It's knocked away and out of bounds, but they're going to get a foul on Ruffin. Trevor Ruffin gets the first foul in the game.
And Louisville right away gets the fast break.